Hallelujah. Shabbat shalom, Israel. For Yahweh here is tough and his chesed, his loving kindness, and endures forever. His words are forever settled in HaShemayah. The men that say that the world has changed or is changing, that the cataclysm, mayhem, the hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes, whatever it may be, that is something that is strange that is happening. But it's not so, Yisrael. Everything is by the orchestration and by the command of Almighty Yahweh. So if Yahweh commands that earthquake hits Japan, that's because of his commandments. If he commands that a tsunami hits the coast of an island or a small nation, it's because of his commandments. It's not because of some kind of strange phenomenon that happens on the earth. It's just because Yahweh has commanded it. He commands the heat in Sudan to rise above the 100 of degrees, and he calls it in the Arctic to go 50, 60, 100 degrees below Celsius, below freezing. It's because of the commandments of Almighty Yahweh. There are so many explanations for what things happen on the earth, but that it is by the hand of Almighty Yahweh. You have scientists that receive grants. You have colleges that receive monies just to try to figure these things out. But yet they will not put the money towards the resources to find out what Yahweh's will is and what we must do as a people and as a nation to stop our transgression and our sinning, that we be a people that is acceptable before his presence. Isn't that something? We have time. There is time for everything. To search out every nook and cranny besides searching out the Torah of Almighty Yahweh and what he desires for us as a people. Shalom, Kol Yisrael. Those that are listening by Viv live stream, those that listen by our small broadcast station here at Cheshire Community, this is a beautiful, it's a lovely day. Of course, every day is beautiful because Yahweh has ordained it. Every day is beautiful because we are alive and we're well. We're able to come into his bed. We're able to lift up our hands. We're able to lift up our voices. We're able to sing. We're able to dance. We're able to bring the offering of praise before the presence of Almighty Yahweh. So yes, it is another beautiful day that Yahweh has made. On the last few weeks, on Kutvei Emet, on Shabbat, you heard from our Zakein Benjamin and Ak Shimri concerning continuing. You heard concerning the blessings, the barakah, the barak of Almighty Yahweh. So I do want to today on this Shabbat kind of bring all those things and mend them together. Of course, they're all mended together in Torah. There's nothing, there's not one scripture you can read and go to another place that it do not tie in, because it is all the word of Almighty Yahweh. It is all words of life. Even when Torah expresses death and destruction, it is still life. Why? Because it is the word of Almighty Yahweh being made manifest. So let us allow his word, his Torah, to be made, to be manifest in us today, Yisrael. Hallelujah. I do want to begin this teaching starting in Bereshith, Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. Because the blessings and the callings of Almighty Yahweh, they are without repentance. In other words, what that is saying, once Yahweh speak a vow or a covenant, it is established. Just as we heard on Wednesday on Kaveh Emet, he cannot go back on his word. By his immutability, he cannot lie. He just is immune from lying. So when he speaks a promise or a commandment or a ketuvah, a ketuvah, unto us as a people, it is forever established. And if we recall, he cannot swear or make a promise to no one higher but himself, because he is the highest on high. He is the one. So he makes a covenant, it cannot be broken. Just as to Yisrael, he promised them of a land, of a rich, what that is simply saying, it is a possession that is given unto them by Almighty Yahweh that no man can take from them. So as we somewhat here and there throughout Torah, look at what Yahweh has done, and examine what he has done, even through the sin and the disobedience of a nation, though he judged us, though there are those that he condemned unto death, yet he kept his promises by still giving those things, the writs, the possession, the land. And that is saying also the possession of his Ahava, the gifts of the kingdom, the gifts of Emunah, the gifts of healing, all those things he gives unto the house, he has not taken those things away. His promises still stand. So what must we do as a nation that we may grasp unto those promises? That those gifts he has given us may be used to the full extent. It is simply obeying his Torah, obeying his commandments, Israel. We cannot see the strength of Almighty Yahweh and his power being manifest to the fullest unless we walk in his mishpah and his Torah. Unless we believe in those things he has instructed. Unless we take hold and refuge on those things he has commanded us. So it says here in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. It says that now Yahweh, he has said unto Abram. And when Yahweh speaks, it is forever settled, Israel. He commanded him. And this is also a commandment unto us, Israel, as a people. As individuals. For we are all individual, but we are brought together in this body of Yahshua HaMashiach. So every part of the body, it is important. So he commands this unto Abram and unto us to get you out of your country. Is he telling us to leave South Carolina? Is he telling us to leave Charlotte? Is that what he is saying? No, that's not what he is saying. Let's go on. He continues by saying, and from your kindred, your cousins, your brother, your father's house, those things you have association and physical attachments to, those things you find hard to let go, those thoughts and those experiences you find hard just to bury under, Israel. That's what he is saying. Just as he said unto the rich young ruler, he was rich. He was young, he had possessions, we have possessions, we have things that we deem that are rich and that is more important unto us than the things of Torah. Yeah. But Yahweh said, just like he said unto the rich young ruler, forsake all that you have, sell it, give it away, that you may follow me. He asked of Yahshua at that time, how should he obtain this promise of eternal life? That is the only way we're going to obtain the promise of eternal life. It's the only way we're going to be happy if we obey what Yahweh commands us. So he said to get off from those things that you find comfort in your flesh. You get away from those thoughts that you find ease, that you are relaxed, that you have laid the Torah, the Mishpah on the back burner. He said, let go of those things. He said, you get away from those things, your country, and from your kindred, and also from your father's house. You know, there are many ethnicities and religions that call the place where they meet their father's house. What about here? What was he expressing unto Abram? His people, his kindred, his father, there were those that worshiped the stars and the luminaries. They did not give Todah unto Yahweh for those things that were created. They worshiped the luminaries, the moon, the sun, the stars. Yahweh was not mentioned in their prayers, nor in their activities. There are those that still do that today. That worship the stars and the moons. They have their names, different names, their gods. They still worship their gods. And if we are not careful, we find ourselves worshiping our own gods. Yahweh said to get away from your father's house. We must get away from those teachings that we have learned in Christianity, in Hinduism. Whatever religion you was a part of that that wiped away the Torah and Yahweh's precious name and the name of Yahshua HaMashiach, you must lay all those things to waste, Israel. That we ascertain those things that Yahweh wants us to have. So we must get away from our father's house. We must get away from those ways of the Baptists and the Methodists. of the first Presbyterians. All those habits and those teachings that do not line up with Torah. We must get away from our father's house, Israel. And he says, unto a land, in the Hebrew, that is rich, the possession, the things I desire you to have. It was more than just the physical land, Israel. It was the riches of those things. It was the wealth that lied within the trees. And all those things, Israel. Yahweh desired and promised them to have those things, just as he desired us to have the Melkut, the kingdom of Almighty Yahweh. But we must lay these things aside. He said, and go unto a land which I will show you. Verse 2. And he said, I will make of you a great nation. Does not Yahweh make of us a great nation? That is the step, what? After we forsake all. We must forsake all to follow Yahshua. We must forsake all the Father, the Torah. The rich young ruler did not want to forsake all. If Abram did not leave his father's house and forsake all that he had learned, his kindred, leave that land to follow what Yahweh commanded, just as the young ruler must follow Yahshua, just as we must follow Yahshua, then there's no way that we would possess these things that Yahweh has given unto us in his promises. There's no way we will become a great nation and a great people that we stand firmly on the promises of Almighty Yahweh. And he says that I will barak you. He said, and I will bless you. I will make nations to bow down before you. He said, I will fight your battles. I will restore those things that were lost and have been lost unto Kol Yisrael. He said, I will barak you. I will bless you. And I will make your name great. And you shall be also a barak, a baraka, a blessing. A nation where all those things, the Torah, the Mitzvah of Almighty Yahweh flow. As we hear so many times, that when other people in nations and religions look at us as a people in the way we live, that we are hava one another, that we are hava Almighty Yahweh. We forsake not his Torah. They understand and see the wisdom of a nation. Why? Because we grow and we prosper. They will look and ask of us, what are we doing? Who is our mighty one? What are you doing as a people in the nation that we're not doing, that you have possessed all these things? That there's a true ahava, a true love for one another and for what you believe that you stand. He said, I will bless you and I will make your name great and I will also make you to be a blessing, a barak. Verse 3. And he said that I will bless them that bless you. There's not too many people that bless you or say thank you, or feel an urge when you give something they feel, even just the urge is enough to repay you some kind of way for what you have done. He said, and those that bless you, he said, I will bless them. And those that curse you, that revile you, that hate you, he said that he will also send the curses unto them. And he says, in you shall all families of the earth. That doesn't leave out any nation or any people. He says all families of the earth. That surpasses religion, ethnicity, belief. How big you are, how small you are, how much money you have, whether you're rich or poor. He said all nations, all families of the nations of the world. They shall be blessed. Hallelujah. They shall be blessed. We must follow the Mishpat. We must obey the Torah. We must walk according to his statutes and his ordinances, Israel. That's the only way we're going to be this people that is described in Torah. Verse 4, he goes on to say, concerning Abram. So Abram, he departed. Now remember, verse 1, 2, and 3 are all the promises of Almighty Yahweh. Verse 1 really exclaiming what he must do that he may receive all these things, these blessings from Almighty Yah. Verse 4. So Abram, he departed. He obeyed. He departed as Yahweh has spoken unto him. So he obeyed Yahweh. He did what he commanded unto him. And Lot went with him, and Abram, he was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran, when he departed out of his country from amongst his people. We would consider that a ripe old age, 75 years old in this time. There's not many people that make it to that age, 75. So even in this, the wisdom, the knowledge, understanding, was it with him? Sure it was. The understanding of Torah, though he was taught and brought all of those things of his father's house, yet Yahweh chose him and he spoke unto him. And he obeyed Yahweh's charge and moved away from his kindred and from his nation, from his people. Verse 5. And Abram, he took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all of their possessions that they had gathered, and the nephesh, or the people that had gotten into Haran, and they went forth to go to the land of the rich, that place of Canaan. And to the land of Canaan they came. So the only way Israel, we should enter into the land of Canaan, we know that Canaan was that place that flowed with milk and honey, as Torah describes unto us. They had no need to worry about food. They didn't have to worry about clothing. Prosperity was spread abroad, mainly because they obeyed what Yahweh commanded them. Canaan was already there and set and prepared, just as the Melchizedek kingdom is set and prepared for us, Yisrael. But are we ready? Are we ready to obey what Yahweh has spoken unto us? Are we willing to forsake all, to forsake our kindred, those whom we deem to be as friends? Are we willing to let all those things go, wife, husband, children, that we may possess this land, the promises of Almighty Yahweh, that we may possess the kingdom, Yisrael? Are we willing? Ask yourself that question. Am I truly willing to stop this? Am I truly willing to forsake that? Am I truly willing to give all for the Melkut, for the kingdom of Almighty Yahweh? And if you are not, why are we here? Why are you wasting your time? So evidently there is a desire, there's a purpose that we as a people, that we're pressing, that we're striving towards, is it not? And that is to walk in the commandments of Almighty Yahweh, just as Abram. Verse 6. And Abram, he passed through the land to the place of Shittim, to the plain of Moreh. And the Canaanites was then in the land. So the Canaanites had possessed the land. Those people already living there. Verse 7. And Yahweh appeared unto Abram and said, that your seed, your children, will I give this land. And there built he an altar unto who?
Yahweh.
Unto Yahweh. Should we stop building the altar? Should there not be a place where Yahweh's name is written, Yisrael, that we offer up the offering of the sacrifice of praise, of Todah unto Yahweh? So as he moved from his people, from his kindred, as he denied and laid aside all those weights and those things that would keep him from walking in the path, one of the first things he did was give Todah unto Almighty Yahweh. See, we must give, Yisrael. We want Yahweh to bestow all these things and his promises unto us, but yet we are not willing to give. And I will get to that as we move on in Torah, the things we should give unto Almighty Yahweh. But the first thing he did is he built an altar. He built a place where he could bring the sacrifice unto Almighty Yahweh of Todah and praise. And Yahweh appeared to him in verse 7, and he said, to your seed will I give this land. And there Abram, he built unto Yahweh an altar, who appeared unto him. So we must build the altar. There should be a place always in our lives where we cease not to give Todah unto Almighty Yahweh. That the offerings that we offer by the fatness, and what is that? That is of the substance of the things that he has given unto us. That is of the riches he has given unto us. We are a rich people, Yisrael. We are. Hallelujah.
Yeah, we are.
So in knowing that and understanding that, that we must give a part. We must give something unto Yahweh. There should be a desire. Just as someone would give something unto you, and you say, man, this is nice. I want to do something. They say, no, don't do nothing, because you're gonna somewhat take away part of my blessing for just giving it to you. I'm not looking for no reward. I'm giving it to you. But still, there's a desire, I have to do something. I'll just wait, and I'll do something for him. I appreciate that. Yahweh wants that from us, Yisrael. He wants us to appreciate what he has done. He wants us to appreciate what he has gone through. That we can say, Todah, thank you, Yahweh. That we build an altar continually, no matter where we are, and offer up a praise of thanksgiving unto him. That's what he wants, Yisrael. That's what Abram did. Why? That there will be a remembrance unto Almighty Yahweh. Why? Because he know that he has brought him, he forsake all things, and it was only by and through Almighty Yahweh that he may possess some portion of land, some kind of inheritance, because he left everything. He left the riches of his father's house. You don't think that people were rich in physical things? Of course they were. You don't think him being the son, that the father had wealth laid back for him just for being a son? Sure he did. Yet he left all those things. And we'll be honest with ourselves, we really didn't have much to really forsake if we would compare ourselves with Abram. But yet we deem even those things that are nothing worth something that we will turn. Why would we turn to go back to those weak and beggarly elements? Why would we turn and go back to sin and transgression the Torah when all we know that those things bring forth is death? It brings a thrill only for a moment. That's, to me, that's no tough. Or as we would say, that's no good. It's worthless. There's no weight to that. Why? Because you find yourselves going back to it again. Drug addicts, they have to go back to that same drug again. You have people that progress, they may do something small, and then they could progress into something heavier and harder. And they always have to go back to those things. Why? Because there's an addiction there. What are we addicted to? Is that something that we think we're hiding in our closet that we continue to go back to that Almighty Yahweh does not see? We're a foolish people if we believe that. Why? Because he sees all, Yisrael, and he knows all. How do you think he can instruct us? How do you think that he would send a messenger or his malach to come to bring a message that causes and causes us to judge our lives? Why? Because there are things in there that we need to clean out. You will hear the statement, skeletons in your closet. And there are those of us that have no room for nothing else. We must clean it out, Yisrael. We must forsake these things. We must lay these things aside that we may possess the blessings that Yahweh has for us. They're there. Just as I talk on Kadvei Emet, the Melkut, it is ready. He's not going to try to put something together at the last minute. It's ready. But we must make ourselves ready. And how do we do that? By obeying the Mishpat, the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. That's the only way. And in that, it should not be a task when he asks us to do something that we dread, that we find hard to do. You know, really, a job, if I may use this example, because it's a true statement, no matter how hard or easy the job is, the steps to complete it, whether it's a job that takes you a few minutes or whether it's a job that takes a couple of years, the process is the same. You have to start it and it has to be finished. You start it and then you finish it. And how you start a job has a lot to do with the processes of that finished work. So if you start a job and you're already complaining, and you're already disgruntled, it's going to make that job harder. It's going to make a 2 or 3 minute job seem like an hour job. An hour job could take 4 or 5 hours. And a job you should finish in a day take you a couple of days. So no matter how large the job is, the attitude we must have as a people should be the same. We should have patience. We should have endurance. And then you will find out, as you're doing a job, it may take a couple of hours. You look back and see what you have done and see what you have accomplished. Well, I do sometimes at a job, I look at what I have accomplished. All right, that's done, that's complete, you go on to the next thing. Because sometimes when you look at what you have to do, it can become overwhelming. You find yourself becoming faint-hearted. Instead of just saying, I'm going to deal with this little bit for now. That's why Yahweh, he wants us to live just as the old song would say, a day at a time. A minute at a time. Why? Because what has to come in the next minute or the next hour, it will make room for itself. Yahweh, he will give us understanding. He will give us wisdom in how to deal with that situation when that situation comes. So we should not be fretting. Has Yahweh started anything that he has not finished? And when he finishes it, it is beautiful. Whether it's death, it is beautiful. Why? Because Yahweh says that one that you think is dead, he just sleeps. Sleep is beautiful. You watch one sleep. Sometimes if I have a little trouble, I look over at my Ishaw. Beautiful as she sleeps. Get up, walk through the house, look at the children all laying in their beds. Sariah, she's the wildest sleeper in the bunch. But yet it's beautiful. Why? Because there's comfort there. There's assurance. There's no worry there. You see a baby sleeping in its crib. It's a beautiful thing. Why? Because that baby have no worries. Everything is taken care of. The diaper gets changed. And we get milk when it wants milk. When the baby wakes up in the middle of the night and calls, well, you have to ask. You have to get up. Yahweh, he desires that from us as a people, that we put our trust in him. Why? Because we're just vain. We're just children. We're the sheep of his pasture, yet he understands what we have need of. So let us rest, Israel, in the comfort of mitzvah and Torah. Let us rest that he has brought us this far by Emunah, even when we did not know him. He brought us through. But now that we know him, let us give him Torah. Let us give him praise. We know it's Yahweh. Let us not despair at the things that we have to conquer and overcome. But let us give Todah that he gives us enough for now and for today, Israel, for us to press and for us to continue. Hallelujah. He knows what we have need of. But we have to give him Todah, Israel. We have to barak him. There's nothing that is too large, no mountain that is too high that we cannot overcome. Why? Because Yahshua HaMashiach is already overcoming. So let us follow in his footsteps. He gave Todah unto Yahweh for everything, even in the midst of battle. He gave Todah unto Almighty Yahweh. Genesis 26, verse 1. I want us to move there. So let us remember Yahweh, even in trials and tribulations, even as we work out our emunah, our faith, with fear and trembling, that each step of the way we give him Todah. We barak him. We bless him that we give unto Almighty Yahweh. So it says here in Bereshit, Genesis chapter 26, verse 1. This is concerning the famine and even the deliverance of Yahweh at this time. And there was a famine in the land. Truly there is a famine in the land. Torah expresses famine as one, not because there's a lack of water or a lack of food, but it's the preaching and the exhortation of the word of Almighty Yahweh. That's what the famine is today. But there's a famine in the land beside the first famine that was in the days of Abram. So this was not the only famine. There were famines. There were times of drought, times of need. And Yitzhak went to Abimelech, king of the Palestines, to Gir, Verse 2. And Yahweh appeared unto him and said, go not down to Mizraim, to Egypt, in the land which I should tell you of. He told him to sojourn in this land, and I will be with you. So even though the famine was there, the famine was great, Yahweh told him not to seek others, not to try to move out of this place, but continue in this way, in this path. Well, it had to have been the will of Almighty Yahweh. It had to have been his desire for him to continue, even though there was famine. Why? Because he said, continue in this land, in verse 3, and I will be with you. That speaks a lot. That speaks great things unto us as a house. No matter how famished our situation or trial that we go through, no matter how harsh or how hard, Yahweh said to continue through this way. Don't try to skirt around it. Don't try to go around the mountain. He said, I want you to climb the mountain and I will be with you. He said, I will be with you. And he says, I will bless. I will barak you. We need the blessings of Almighty Yahweh. I desire and want the blessings of Almighty Yahweh. But we must do what? We must continue. He told him to sojourn. Don't turn around. We heard that from our Akim and from our Zakane. To continue. To abide, to stay. So he told him to continue in this land or in this path. And he said, I will barak you, I will bless you. For unto you and unto your Zerah will I give all of these countries, all of this land, all of the possessions. Don't you know that Yahweh has given us all things, Yisrael? Even all things in Yahshua HaMashiach. You know, the world belongs unto us as a people and as a nation. It truly does. Yahweh has given it into the hands of Kol Yisrael, his people. So shall he restore those things as they once were? Yes, he will. We find that example throughout Torah. As a nation displeased Almighty Yahweh, just as we have. That's why we're in this situation that we are in, Yisrael, because we have displeased Almighty Yahweh. But yet because of his promises, that he shall have a people unto himself, there shall be a people that is strong and that is rich in wealth, not only that, in wisdom and understanding. He said, I will have that. I will have that nation. I will have that people. But yet it's the things that must take place that we are ready for these responsibilities, because they are responsibilities. We must be ready. So this is a process, our lives, day to day, making ourselves ready. What? For the Melkut, for the will of Almighty Yahweh. You know, we all said this in our times when we were saved, as they would say. When we understood and realized that it is Yahweh that has opened our eyes, that we will be willing to do anything for the sake of the kingdom. Do we still have that, Yisrael? Do we still have that desire and that press that we're willing to forsake all for the Melkut, for the kingdom? That's a day-to-day battle that we must do. It's a day-to-day responsibility, this preparation for the kingdom. But it's the only way, Israel, y'all, that we're going to be able to enter in. So he said unto him, you obey, you continue in the path. Even in this time of famine and drought, he said, even all these nations, this people, these countries, he said, I will give them unto you. And I will perform again, we have seen this time for time, the promise, the oath, which I have swore unto Abram, your father. And what was that oath? That he would give him of the nations, that he would multiply the children and the people, and that there would be a great nation unto Almighty Yahweh. Hallelujah. And verse 4, as it continues, he said, I will make your Zerah, your seed, to multiply as the stars of Hashemayah. Can we count the stars? Does anyone know how many stars there are in the Shemayah? Can you count the ones which you just can see from this sphere or where we stand? Don't you know you can stand here and see the stars? And you can be 100 miles away and see the same stars? And more so, we can't see everything just from one spectrum. We talk about stars that surround the Olam, that are throughout what they call the galaxies, which is just is the realm of Almighty Yahweh. We don't know how many stars are out there. So him using that as an example, he says unto him as a promise that he will multiply you as the stars of the Shemayim, and he will give your seed, your Zerah, all of these countries. And in your seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Who are blessed today? Who are blessed by you? Who are you blessing? Do not Torah tell us to do tov unto all men? We should do tov. That's a responsibility for us to do tov, to do those things that are right, that are tzedek unto all men, but especially those of the bed of Yisrael. And if we don't do those things as Yahweh has commanded, we will not receive one blessing. Is the blessing there? It is there. But are we ready? Are we prepared for the blessing? Do we give Yahweh told out in advance for the blessing? Hallelujah. Why? Because it is prepared. There was other people that was in these nations, in these countries already, but Yahweh said, I'm going to give them to you because you are mine. You are my possession. And I have laid an oath and a promise that you shall possess these things. If we look at what we have, we don't really have much, do we, Israel? But we have each other. We have the promises of Almighty Yahweh that we stand on these promises that he will give and has given all these things unto us as a people. He will not hold back his wisdom. He will not withhold any understanding. If we will ask of him, many times we don't even ask of Almighty Yahweh for many things, Israel. Sure, he knows what we have need of, but he wants us to ask. He wants us to proclaim those things that he has given and promised unto us, Yisrael. The Torah says that the cattle upon a thousand hill, it belongs unto Almighty Yahweh. And we as being his people and his nation, we possess those same possessions. We possess all those things, Yisrael. So he told him that he will barak his Zerah, and there will be a blessing unto all the nations of the earth. Verse 5. This is what we must do in verse 5, just as Abram did. He said, because that Abram, did not he lay that promise or that oath, first of all, with Abram? And Abram, what did he do in verse 5? He obeyed. Now, obeying Israel is more than just one going and doing a thing. It's deeper than that. Obeying is, first of all, hearing the instruction. Because how can you obey an instruction without, first of all, hearing it? You know, sometimes even with children and with us, when you're instructed to do something, you go do it, you leave something out. Well, we didn't really listen intently. We left out a detail. We heard that, but we did not hear the other part. So we come back doing the job that we have been sent to do only halfway, so it is not finished. Here it said that Abram, he obeyed. He heard, and in that hearing, he obeyed. He did those things that was commanded by Almighty Yahweh. He said that he heard and obeyed my voice, and he kept my charge. We must keep Yahweh's charge. We must keep his charge, Israel. He charged us to love one another. We have to keep that charge. And it really should not be nothing difficult about it, but we find it hard. Sometimes even to love ourselves, as we should. But we must keep the charge of Almighty Yahweh. He tells us not to walk after false things or false gods. But we find ourselves trying to walk after those things. Going after those things, forgetting his commandments and what he desires us, Yisrael. He said, and keep my charge and my commandments, my kudveh, the mitzvah. Not only that, he said, and to keep my statutes and my Torah. He said, that's why I have kept this oath unto you. I have been faithful, Yahweh's explaining unto him. Why? Because your father foremost obeyed what was commanded unto me. We must obey what's commanded of us, Israel. Did not Yahshua obey Almighty Yahweh in all things? Do we not think that Yahshua had access to all the riches and the things of the kingdom and the Olam? Well, we must follow after his footsteps, should we not? Is he not our shepherd? Is he not our father? Should not we follow in his stead and in his footsteps? And by doing so, we shall receive of the same blessings that he has promised by his word, that Yahweh has promised. Hallelujah. I want to read this account in the 22nd chapter of Jubilees, beginning at verse 1. Because even in death, Yisrael, at the point of death, we should barak Yahweh. There have been those that have faced their deathbeds and go out with nothing but complaining. There are those that have faced their last day and they go out with nothing but fear. Those that have faced their last days, their last breath, without any conscience or idea where they are in their present status in their situation. But we as a people, in our last days, we should give todah and praises unto Almighty Yahweh. Even here we will find one that knew his time. And up until that time, he obeyed Yahweh. Yahweh gave him the things he said he would. He kept his promise, his oath. And yet he passed it on to his sons, that they would go on. He passed the Torah, the words of wisdom, unto his sons, even in this time of Jubilee. And the time of Jubilee is a time where the nation and the people, they came together with banquets, eating. They drank, not to the point of drunkenness where they commit sins and abominations before Almighty Yahweh, but it was a time of excitement, of dancing, and of praise, where everybody brought their resources together and gave todah unto Almighty Yahweh for the things he has done for that year and for past times. Why? Because Yahweh, he is faithful. And he is worthy of all praise, Israel. He's worthy for us to give him todah. So it says here in 2nd Jubilees, if you don't have to, just pay attention, just listen. And Yitzhak and Ishmael, they came to celebrate the Feast of Weeks before Abram's death. So this man we are talking about is Abram. He has seen all the things that Yahweh has done. He has walked in the statutes and in the promises of Almighty Yahweh from the very, very beginning, even until now, where he is about to pass or die. And it came to pass that at the first week of the 44th Jubilee, and in the second year, this is the year in which Abram, he died, he passed, that Yitzhak and Ishmael, they came from the well of the oath, that's where they came from, the place, in parentheses, to celebrate the Feast of Weeks. That is the Feast of First Fruits. Do we not uphold that Feast of First Fruits, Israel? Yes, we do. Of the harvest to Abram their father, and Abram, he rejoiced because his two sons had came. So he rejoiced because his sons came to visit him, even at this point of death, in the time of these weeks of Jubilees or this time of feast or in gathering, his sons came to visit him. You know, I want those of like minded to visit me in my last time. Why? Because at those times you need strength. You need a whole king to stand there, to be there with you. Hallelujah. We should stand with one another, Israel. We should stand, as they say hand in hand. Why? Because we have the same desire. We have the same goals. And that is to make it into the Melkut, to obey Almighty Yahweh. He said, for Yitzhak had made many possessions in Beersheba. And Yitzhak, he went out to go to see the possessions and to return unto his father. And in those days, Ishmael came to see his father. And they came together. And Yitzhak, he offered a zebah, a sacrifice of burnt offerings, and presented it on an altar of his father, which he had made in Haran. Do you recall that altar he made in Haran? Did I not talk about that? Where he moved from his father's house when he obeyed Almighty Yahweh and left all those things, and he came into the land, the place that Yahweh intended him to have, that flowed with milk and honey, the first thing he did was made an altar unto Almighty Yahweh. So his sons, even in their travels to visit his father, they visit and stopped at that same altar to offer a burnt offering unto Almighty Yahweh. Hallelujah. That altar was left there as a remembrance, as a memorial unto Almighty Yahweh. So should we as a people leave memorials? Should there not be a place of remembrance in our minds what Yahweh has done in past times? That when our children come to those same places and those same points in life as we have, that there will be a memorial before them to remember Almighty Yahweh. That should be something we should desire to leave behind, Israel. Just as Abram did. We should leave an altar. We should leave a place of todah and praise for what Yahweh has brought us out of and what he is bringing us into his promises, Israel. That our children can find those same places and offer praise unto Almighty Yahweh. That's what we should want to do. Hallelujah. And presented on it this altar of his father, which he had made in Haran. Verse 4. And he offered a thanks offering that he had made of a feast of joy before Ishmael, his brother. And Rebekah made new cakes from the new grain and gave them unto Yaakov, her son, to take them to Abram, his father, from the first fruits of the land. You see how they gathered the resources? This was the cakes from the first grains of the new other fruit offerings. That he might eat and that he might be blessed of the Creator, of Almighty Yahweh, of all things before he passed. So they made him a meal. They took up those first things, those first fruits, after they offered it unto Almighty Yahweh, and she made cakes, that Abram may enjoy the fruits of their labor and the blessing of Almighty Yahweh before he passed. This is what we should all do when one come to those latter days, those latter times, that we're there to comfort, that we're there to give todah unto Almighty Yahweh, not to complain. Sure, there will be times where our hearts, legs will be broken to see one go on. But it's not a sorrow to the point where we displease or we disannul Almighty Yahweh. But we told Yahweh that he's taken one that is so precious, that they're going to sleep, that it's a beautiful thing. Torah even says better is the death of one. Why? Because in that they leave something behind. They leave a memorial behind. Our Zakein, when they pass, or even the youth, if that be Yahweh's will, his desire, that they leave something behind. They leave a memorial behind, a remembrance behind for us to go on, Israel. That's all this was. That when others of the same mind would pass by the altar, there would be zakar, remember, of the blessings that Almighty Yahweh has given, and to give todah unto Almighty Yahweh. It's just that simple. And it's just that easy, Israel. Verse 5, and Yatzah he took and sent by the hand of Yaakov to Abram the best thanks offering that he might eat and drink. So they took of the best of the thank offering. And he ate and drank, and he blessed Almighty Yahweh Most High, who has created the Shemayims and the Olam, who has made all the fat things of the earth, all the rich things, all the wealth, all the first fruits of the harvest. He gave todah unto Almighty Yahweh. And he has given them unto the children of men that they might eat and drink and be blessed by their Creator. So even as we eat and we drink, as we dine, Israel, we should remember to give todah unto Almighty Yahweh, to barak him. Because it is by the blessings of Almighty Yahweh that we're able to eat, that we're able to drink. Verse 7. And now I give todah unto you, my sovereign master, Almighty Yahweh, because you have caused me to see this day. Abram said, you have kept me unto this day of my death, that I might see this day of gathering, this day of rejoicing, this day of plenty, this time of plenty. He said, I baruch you that you have brought me to this day that I should die, that I should pass. It could have been any other day, but Abram believed this was the day that Yahweh desired to take him in this time of plenty, this time of harvest. And look at his age. He said, behold, I am 175 years old. So his years more than double since the last account we heard of his age. More than double. So Yahweh has been tough. Do you think Abram went back on the promises of Almighty Yahweh? You think Abram turned his heart away from Yah anytime? Let's see what Torah has to say. Because this is a testimony unto his sons and all Yisrael, even us that are here today, of one that stands on the promises of Almighty Yahweh, that continues, that told Yahweh for everything. There were not always tough, or if I would say good times. There were also times of famine. But yet, because he stayed where Yahweh told him to stay, he did not move. Yahweh blessed him. Yahweh barak him. We're not going to be blessed, Israel, if we continue to move here, if we move there. We believe this, we believe that. We have faith, we have emunah, and tomorrow we have no emunah. We love Yahweh greatly today, and tomorrow we don't love Yahweh. The Torah says that a false balance, it is an abomination before Almighty Yahweh. So we cannot present unto Yahweh an offering that is full of abominations, because we cannot stay, because when trials come, we run. And we turn and we flee. When there's a famine, when times are dry, we think we can find something better somewhere else. When Yahweh commands us to stay, stay put where you are. He said, I will barak and I will bless you. I will multiply you. Again, verse 7, he said, behold, I am 175 years old. He said, I am an old man and full of days. He said, Yahweh has not cheated me of my days. He said, I'm an old man. I'm an old man. Yes, 175 years old. I mean, when you see one that is 100, I believe we had a customer that said that their parents lived to be 90, and there's a couple that said 100, and I think one said 102. I mean, it's almost a feat that you would say, man, that's old. But 175, that's old. That's quite a few years. That's many years. That's more years than people see today. Because of sin, because of iniquity, because what we have done to our bodies, because of sin. But what I want to get to is what he done through these years. He did not waste his time. He did not waste Yahweh's time, because he stood on his promises. And he knew what Yahweh expected before him, for him. He said, I'm an old man full of days. And he said, and all my days have been unto me shalom. He said, full of peace. All 175 days. He said, all my days. He said, I have no complaints. He said, I give Yahweh todah no matter what come my way. I have stood on his promises. I have obeyed his word. Even when times were hard, I stayed in his mitzvah, in his Torah. I stayed rooted in his word. We must stay rooted in Yahshua, because the same word Abram stood on in Yahshua is the same word we stand on today. He said, all 175, he said, all my days, all these years, he said, I have been, all these years have been unto me shalom. I don't believe he lied. He obeyed Yahweh. Yahweh provided what he needed, food, raiment, clothing, whatever was needed. He said, all my days were days of shalom. In verse 8, and he also said, and the sword of the adversary has not overcome me. My enemies, the trials, my friends, my family, whoever it may be. See, sometimes the closest one to you can be your enemy, your wife, your brothers, your sisters, your closest friend. You're even an enemy unto yourself. But he said, all these days, the sword of my adversary have not overcome me. And all that you have given me and my children all the days of my life, even unto this day. That's a testimony of the faithfulness of Almighty Yahweh. Not only that, that's a testament unto Abram that he stood on those promises. And because he stood on those promises, even his children, the sword did not come unto them. Hallelujah. Our enemy should not have preeminence or power over us, Yisrael, if we will stand just as Abram stood. That's a testimony right there. If we will stand on his promises, the sword never entered into his house all 175 years. He saw shalom. There was peace in the midst of the congregation that dwelt there with Abram. Do we think Yahweh would do any less of us or for us if we would just walk in his statutes, Israel? Yeah. It is not hard. What makes it hard is our sin. We try and we desire to continue in our sin and our iniquities. And we're not going to receive the blessings of Almighty Yahweh. We're not going to have the shalom that Abram had if we don't walk according to his Torah. If we don't give Torah unto Yahweh in all things. Why? Because he is in control of all things. Famine, he is in control. When you don't have a dime in your pocket, he's in control. If you wear the very shoes off your feet, he is in control, Yisrael. So we must give Torah unto Yahweh for all things, just as Abram. Hallelujah. Is that not a testimony? Is that not the same thing? Is that not what Yahshua did? Did not he obey and please Almighty Yahweh and call in all things? All things. Hallelujah. I want to move on to First Baruch, verse 17. Because if we do not walk after the commandments of Almighty Yahweh, then we will receive of Almighty Yahweh also the curses. Do we not hear about the curses? Have we not heard about the curses from Almighty Yahweh? Because we disobey his mitzvah. See, Abram, he received the blessings of Almighty Yahweh 175 years because he walked in Torah. Well, this is an example of us as a people, and an example in Torah here in First Baruch concerning those that do not walk after the mitzvah, the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. Those that forget his Torah, that do not give him Torah, Yahweh, he has judgment. And his judgment is harsh and it is cruel. But yet, even in that, as we venture through this chapter, we will see yet his promises is still firm. They still remain in the land. He did not take them out of the way. But Yahweh placed things in the way because of the sin. See, we are still on the same path to the Melkut, the kingdom. But depending on how or what we do concerning Torah and how we obey Almighty Yahweh, will this walk be one of shalom? Or will we be a people that is against Yah and Yahweh is against us? If Yahweh is against us, then we are brought to nothing. We're brought to dust. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah, you saw the end of that people, the end of that nation, that city, that there was nothing left, just ashes. They were consumed. Yahweh consumed those certain ones in the wilderness. Did they continue on the way? Yes, they continued on the way. They continue to the place where Yahweh has elected that place that they will go to possess. So even on this path, this way to the kingdom, we're going to possess the kingdom, are we not, Israel? That's why we are in this path. That we may enter to the Melkut, the kingdom, but yet we must have the mindset, the kingdom mindset, today. Today, before it's too late. Why? Because there are woes, there are judgments that lie in this path and in this way. And they will consume you and destroy you. Though his promises rest assured, yet we must walk according to his ordinances, his commandments, Yisrael, that we may receive those things. We're not going to receive his commandments walking in sin, walking in rebellion, disobeying the elders. You young ones, disobeying your parents. You're not going to receive the blessings, the barakah of Almighty Yahweh. So let us read this here, and what it says in 1 Baruch chapter 1, starting at verse 17. There's a lot here in this chapter, but I just picked this out that we may have an example today. And believe me, we will not escape today. I have not escaped. Hallelujah. Because Yahweh, he knows what we have need of, Yisrael. It says in 1 Baruch, chapter 1, verse 17. This is a confession unto Almighty Yahweh. For we have sinned before Abba Yahweh. Do we confess we have sinned before Yahweh? Yeah. I have sinned and have sinned greatly. Yeah. Hallelujah. I have sinned above all men. That is my testimony. Yeah. I have sinned. Yeah. We must confess our faults unto Almighty Yahweh, to one another. Yeah. And that doesn't mean you tell someone of all the things that has happened in your life. That's not what he's saying. But we must confess that we are filthy, that we are undone. I'm no better than the next op. I need the prayers of my op. I need the helping hand of my op that I may stand in this walk, in this battle, in this path to the Melkut. Hallelujah. Verse 18. And I have disobeyed him. We have disobeyed Almighty Yahweh. Do we all confess we have disobeyed? Hallelujah. See, even in that, we should give Todah unto Yahweh because he is still faithful. Even in your disobedience, he is still faithful. And even in your disobedience, his promises still stand firm. Hallelujah. He said, and disobeyed him, and have not hearkened unto the voice of Almighty Yahweh, your Abba. We have not hearkened. That is, we have not obeyed. We have not listened. Again, obeying is more than just one goal. Somebody could go do a thing and still be rebellious about what they do. And the result of that is still no good. There's still no tub. There's no life that comes out of that. We must first of all hear and receive. And then obey the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. And that's where the blessings come from. That's where the life comes from. And disobey him and have not hearkened to his voice, to the voice of Almighty Yahweh, what? To walk in the commandments that he has gave us openly. Why did he have to say openly? Why? Because his commandments have not been hid under a rock. We don't have to go out and try to search for his commandments. He has given his commandments unto us in an open book by examples. By Yahshua HaMashiach, as we look to him for all things and the way we must go in his commandments, he has not hid them from us, Yisrael. They're open. That's why he expressed that. We have not walked in his commandments that Yahweh has given unto us openly. We have not walked in his commandments. Verse 19. He says, since the day that Yahweh brought our forefathers out of the land of Egypt, out of the land of Mizraim. So we have been a people and a nation that has continued to sin, to transgress, to fall short of the honor and the praises that are due unto Almighty Yahweh. He said, even to this present day. Was he talking about then? He was talking about then. Yes, he was, but this is expressed unto us now. It's a living word. He's speaking unto us now. He said, even from our days where we have been brought from Mizraim, Yahweh has opened his truth unto us, even unto now. We have found ourselves walking out of the path, walking out of his way. He said, we have been disobedient unto Yahweh, our Almighty, and have been neglectful. Now, it's one thing to forget to do something, a responsibility, but it's another thing to neglect it. Why? Because you have the knowledge of that, and still you steer around it. You avoid it. He said, we have avoided your Torah. Your Torah has been open unto us. You have sent your Melekim, your Malak, your messenger. He has opened the Torah before us, and we have walked contrary to your will, Yahweh. He said, we have been neglectful in not hearing his voice. So this is not something that we just do. We have decided. This is something we made in our own heart that we would neglect. By not hearing the voice of Almighty Yahweh. Verse 20. He said, wherefore the evils they have cleaved, they have grasped onto us, and the curses. And Yahweh has appointed by Moshe his servant at the time that he had brought our fathers out of the land of Mizraim to give us the land that flows with milk and honey, like as it is to this day. So have not Yahweh still given us the land? He has still given us the land. But yet we have received of the curses of Moshe and those things because we have walked not according to the blessings or the promises of Almighty Yahweh, those things he had commanded. The commandments that are right here. We find ourselves steering around them. Not putting no God before us. Not coveting what is your neighbor's. We find ourselves steering around those things, he says. Even unto this day, verse 21. Nevertheless, we have not hearkened unto the voice of Yahweh, our Almighty, according to all the words of the prophet, the Nabi. So there was a prophet. Was there not Moshe? He was there, was he not? Aharon? To present the offerings? To tell the people where they must go, what they must do? He said, according to the words of the prophets, who he has sent before us. So Yahweh, he sends messengers before us to speak. He sends messengers before us to instruct us. When we think we're getting away, the messenger says something that, I need to come up on that. I have not done that. He's speaking to us today, Israel. We must take heed. He said, even unto this day. In verse 21, he says, nevertheless, we have not hearkened unto the voice of Yahweh our Almighty, according to all the words of the prophet that he has sent unto us. But every man, they follow the imagination of his own wicked heart. Are not our hearts wicked and deceivable? The heart of man is wicked and is deceivable above all things. And it is what? Desperately wicked. That's your heart. That's my heart. That's our heart. That's the heart of man. That's why we must have the love, the heart of Yahshua HaMashiach, to desire to obey Yahweh in all things. So everyone followed the imaginations of his wicked heart to serve strange gods and to do evil in the sight of Yahweh, our Almighty. I want to skip down to the next chapter. First Baruch, chapter 2, verse 1. Because this is the judgment of Yahweh upon a people that do not walk in his stature, his covenant, and in his promises. First Baruch, chapter 2, verse 1. Therefore, Yahweh has made Tov his word, which he has pronounced against us. So we must understand the promises of Yahweh that without repentance, once he speaks something, it is forever settled. So many times we want to just look on the blessing aspect, which in Hebrew, blessing and curses, it is the same. It is expressed by the same word. But not only does Yahweh barak or bless us when we consider tough things, there are also curses or the things that he has expressed. If we do not walk after his Torah, then those same promises now that never fail, they will be executed. They will be done unto us. Those same blessings will be given unto us. And they still all come from Almighty Yahweh. Both blessings and cursing. The barak, it comes from Almighty Yahweh. Therefore, Yahweh has made Tov his word, which is forever ever settled, which he has pronounced against us and against our judges that judge Yisrael. So they had their own judges at this time that judged Yisrael. When Yahweh has already sent a Nabi, he has sent a prophet, he has sent a messenger. And they said his words against our kings and against our princesses and against the men of Israel and Yehuda. Verse 2, to bring us to great plagues. Do we recall the plagues of Mizraim? Were not those plagues sent by Almighty Yahweh? When Moshe spoke, those plagues did they not come to fluration? Each plague came to fluration when Moshe spoke those things unto us. We're not going to escape the judgment of Almighty Yahweh, because just as the kingdom has been established by his mishpah, so is his judgments have been established. They're the same, Israel. They're the same. So what are we working towards? The blessings or the curses of Almighty Yahweh? By his judgment, we shall receive of one or the other, Yisrael, depending on how we are walking according to his Torah. So these great plagues, all these things come upon this people in Baruch because of the disobedience. Let me read on. Verse 2, to bring upon us great plague, such has never happened under the whole Shemayim. This is after Mizraim. So even those plagues that we talked about that were sent, he said because of their sin, Yahweh has brought upon this nation, this people, plagues that have never been heard upon the Olam or in the Shemayim. And it has come to pass in Yerushalayim, according to the things that were written in the Torah of Moshe. Verse 3. That a man should eat the flesh of his own son. Have we found people doing that? Even in the house of Yisrael? It's more than just a physical, it's more than me taking my son and me biting him and eating him. But it's because me not walking according to the Torah that I allow them to be consumed by the things of the world. I sacrifice him in the fire of Moloch and Molchah. Why? Because I have transgressed against Almighty Yahweh and have turned and have set aside his Torah. That allows or causes your children also to be consumed, Yisrael. He said that a man should eat the flesh of his own son and the flesh of his own daughter. Verse 4. Moreover, he has delivered them to be in subjection to all the kingdoms that are round about us. Now we have heard, as long as we walk in the Mishpat and the Torah, the commandments of Almighty Yahweh, that all the nations, the people, the kingdom will be submitted unto us. If we disobey Yah, he says that those same nations will be your oppressors and they will rule over you. He said, he has delivered us to subjection under all the kingdoms that are round about us to be as a reproach, to be as shame and desolate among the people round about, where Yahweh, he has scattered them, he has scattered us, and he has truly scattered us, Yisrael, throughout the world and throughout the nations. Thus we are cast down and not exalted, because we have sinned against Yahweh, our Almighty, and have not been obedient unto his voice. So the Torah, it both works for us, and it also works against us, does it not? If we do not walk according to the statutes, then those same things that Yahweh has proclaimed unto us as a people, that we should overcome, that we should be exalted, then if we do not walk after those things, we should be diminished, brought low, brought under captivity. Look at the world today. Everybody's in captivity by the nations, by the world, by the leaders, and how they lead a people. There's no true shalom in the world, Yisrael. So even as we have been brought low, as it is stated in Scripture, yet the promise of Yahweh still stands sure. So even us, as us being a small assembly, those that are listening by Viv live stream, you're scattered here, you're there. Yet we must continue in the path and the way that Yahweh has ordained for us to walk. That he will continue to keep us and to preserve us, Yisrael. Verse 7. For all these plagues have come upon us, which Yahweh has pronounced against us. Yet have we not prayed before Almighty Yahweh. That's a shameful statement. That even after all the things that were experienced, because there were those that transgressed the mishpah, yet we did not repent, we did not pray unto Almighty Yahweh. If we recall in Revelation, they said that those that are filthy shall be filthy still, and those that are clean shall remain clean. And even there was a point, even after all those judgments and the plagues that came in Revelation, there was a people that still yet did not repent. But even more so in their anger and displeasure, they mocked Almighty Yahweh for what he has done. That's a vile and that's a wicked, corrupt spirit, Yisrael. And that should not dwell in the midst or in the congregation of Almighty Yahweh. They said, we have not prayed before Yahweh that we might be turned, everyone from the imagination of his wicked heart. He said, there was not even one that prayed for the levs to be turned, to be brought back unto Almighty Yahweh. Again, this is the curse unto Almighty Yah, from Almighty Yahweh to a nation that do not walk according to his statutes. Verse 9. Wherefore Yahweh has watched over us for evil. He said he has watched over us for evil. And Yahweh has brought it, the evil, upon us. For Yahweh, he is Tzaddik. In all this, Yahweh is righteous. In all his judgment, he is still righteous, is he not? Because all these things was brought because of his promises. That if you transgress my Torah, then these are the things that will befall you as a people. Therefore, Yahweh, he watched over us with evil, and Yahweh has brought upon us, for Yahweh is righteous, and all of his works which he has commanded unto us. Yet we have not hearkened unto his voice to walk in his commandments that he has set before us. Verse 11. He says, and now, O Yahweh, the Almighty One of Israel, that has brought your people out of the land of Mizraim with a mighty hand and a high arm and with signs and with wonders and with great power, and have not gotten yourself for a name as appeared this day. And he's still pleading with Almighty Yahweh, saying, oh, Yahweh, our Almighty. He said, we have sinned. We have done wickedly. We have dealt unrighteously in all of your ordinances. He said, let your wrath be turned from us, for we are but few left among the heathen. So were there not those that was being destroyed? Well, did they not still dwell in that place where Yahweh commanded them? They were still in the same nation. But so say the tables turned because of the iniquity of transgression. And those that were under them became their oppressors. Are we allowing things that we have overcame, that we have put under our feet because of our sin, oppress us once again, Yisroel? Have we turned back into the world? Have we turned back into the old thoughts and the old ways, Yisroel? We should not. We should not. We must continue in Yahweh's way. He's pleading to turn your wrath from us, Almighty Yahweh, because we are left but a few among the heathen of this nation where you have turned. He said, well, you have scattered us. Verse 14. He cries, hear our prayers, O Almighty Yahweh, and our petition, and deliver us for your own sake, and give us favor in the sight of them which have led us away. That the earth may know that you are Yahweh, our Almighty, because Yisroel and their posterity is called by your name, Yisroel, and all that is Yisroel is called by the name of Almighty Yahweh. The possessions, all the belongings, all the people belong unto Almighty Yahweh. Verse 16, he says, O Yahweh, look down from your Kodesh house and consider us. Bow down your ear, O Yahweh, from Hashemayim, and hear us. That's one thing that Dawid, throughout the Tehillim, he prayed that Yahweh would give his ear. We need Yahweh to give his ear. Our desire should be that Yahweh give his ear, because we are a nation of transgression and we are a wicked people. But yet, even in our repentance, as we desire these things to be lifted from us, the curses that Yahweh has put on a nation and a people, that he would just give his ear, that he would hear our cries, that he would hear our plea, Yisroel. He says, consider us, Almighty Yahweh, and bow down your ear, O Yahweh, to hear us. He says also in 17, to open your eyes and behold, for the dead that are in the graves, who nephesh are taken from their bodies, will give unto Yahweh neither praise nor righteousness. He's saying those that have passed, that have died, he said they cannot give you praise from the grave. We cannot praise Yahweh from Seol or from the ground, Yisroel. So while we're alive, just as Abram in his life, he continued to give Todah praise unto Yahweh. Because once you pass in this life, you cannot give praise or Todah to Yah. So while today is today, we still yet here. and the thoughts of our mind have been ordained by Almighty Yahweh. Let us give him praise. Let us give him Todah. Let us Barak him, because you cannot give him praise or thank him from the grave, Israel. Hallelujah. You cannot thank him from the grave. He says in verse 18, but the nephesh is greatly vexed, which goes and stoops and are feeble, and the eyes that fail, and the hungry nephesh will give you praise and righteousness, Almighty Yahweh. He said, those of us that are left, we're weak, we're hungry, we're weak. We're broken down because of our sins, and you have judged us because of our sins of our iniquities. It says, while we are yet alive, he said, we will give you praise and we will give you Todah. Verse 19, therefore, we do not make our humble supplication before you, O Yahweh, our Almighty, for the righteousness of our fathers and of our kings. For you have sent out your wrath and your indignation upon us, as you have spoken by your servants, the prophets. So he had already spoken those things. And if we will recall and recollect in Torah, those things we should not do. They're written right here on the plaques that are behind me, the things we should not do. Saying, thus saith Yahweh, bow down your shoulders to serve the king of Babylon. So shall you remain in the land that I give unto your fathers. So were they not yet in the land? Yahweh said, if you desire to remain, he said, then I want you to obey the king of Babylon. If we desire to find any kind of shalom, we must obey the king, yet still. Obama, he's there to do what Yahweh charged him to do. Whoever may take the office after him, he's there because Yahweh ordained him and elected him to be there. Hallelujah. So what should we do as a nation? Even at this time? We should not do anything to transgress the mitzvah of the Torah, but we're not going to take up arms and be standing in front of the White House either. So we're going to do those things that will bring shalom to the nation, to the house of Kol Yisrael. We're not going to be fools. We're going to obey Torah, but we're also going to let Yahweh have his way and whoever he puts in office. Hallelujah. And that we should dwell in shalom. He said, if you desire to dwell or to remain, he says, Yahweh does say, Yahweh, bow down yourself or your shoulders and serve the king of Babylon. So shall you remain in the land that I gave unto your fathers. So yet, even in all these things, the judgments of Yah, the afflictions that was brought upon the people, yet they still remained in the land. Yahweh's promise still stood sure. The land still belonged unto Kol Yisrael. It's only because of the sin and the iniquity, Yisrael. Please open your ears today. We must stop the sin. We must stop the transgression before Almighty Yahweh. Verse 22. He said, but if you will not hear the voice of Almighty Yahweh, and his voice was to say this, to serve and obey the king of Babylon, he said, I will cause to cease out of the cities of Yehuda and also from out of Jerusalem, the voice of mirth and the voice of joy and the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, and the whole land shall be in desolation of inhabitations, of the inhabitants. So what Yahweh is saying in all those voices, don't we desire to hear the voice of the bridegroom? We should desire to hear the voice of the bridegroom. We should desire to hear the voice of joy. The voice of shalom, just as it stated here. The voice of the bride. The voice of mirth are those things that bring a sweet smelling smell to the nostrils of Almighty Yahweh. That those things will proceed and continue to flow from Jerusalem. But he said, you have to obey what I have commanded concerning the king. So if we don't obey what Yahweh has commanded, then all these things, these voices, will be taken from the camp of Israel. His word, his mitzvah, his Torah, all those things that bring us comfort, consolation, shalom, peace, will be taken away. So should we obey Almighty Yahweh? We should obey him in all things, Israel, and we should give him Todah. If taxes, if they go up, the gas go up, we should still give him Todah. Why? Because we're still in this land. Yahweh has promised that we possess this, but we still must walk after those things he has given us. Food prices, they continue to go up. I've heard they're even like the eggs that we usually receive from Sam's. We get them by the cases. They've almost doubled for what we was paying. So the world and the things of the world, they're going to continue, Yisrael, but we must continue in his mitzvah and his Torah and give him praise, Todah, for all things. Hallelujah. Todah. Somewhat to bring us an enlightenment, Yisrael, before I bring this to a close today, let us continue the rest of the service in Tehillim. Hallelujah. Concerning this, and how Yahweh gives unto us as a people, as a nation, and how we should give unto Almighty Yahweh. So, Dawid, if you would turn with me to Tehillim chapter 18, verse 46, I want to begin reading. So, what should we do as a people that we may remain in Yahweh's will? His will being his hafiz, those things that brings joy unto him, that pleases him, that causes him to smile. He smiles upon Yisrael. Hallelujah. Well, one of the most important things is praise. Tehillim 18:46. Dawid expresses that Yahweh, he lives. And he says, bless, praise be the rock, and let Almighty Yahweh, our sovereign master of our salvation, of our Yashak, be exalted. Hallelujah. He says in 47 that it is Yahweh that avenges me. It is Yahweh that avenges me. My enemies, they come up against me for hurt or for harm, but I leave it in the hands of Almighty Yahweh. Why? Because he fights my battles. He avenges me. I don't seek vengeance. To repay, it is Yahweh that repays. And he subdues the people under me. Verse 48. He says, he delivered me from my enemies. Yes, Yahweh, you lift me above those that rise up against me. He says, you have delivered me from the violent man. We must remember, for quite some time, that he was fleeing for his own life. From his enemies. From those that sought to destroy him. But yet he said that, Yahweh, you deliver me from them all. In verse 49, he said, wherefore I not give thanks to you. What does he say there? Who's here with me in Tehillim 18, verse 49? What do the first few words say there? Therefore will I unto Yahweh, even in all that, enemies pursuing him, trying to take his life. Did you notice the enemy that always pursues us? Shaitan. He comes in or comes like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour now. We cannot open the door to the enemy, because if he finds space, believe me, he will take advantage of that. He's shrewd. He's not a dumb enemy, Yisrael. If Yahweh desires the hedge to be broken, he will come in and try us just like he tried Eo. But did Eo fall in the end? No, he did not. As we heard, he was increased even more so. But we cannot allow the enemy any kind of space. So he says, therefore will I give Todah unto you, O Yahweh, among the heathen, and I will sing to your name. He says, great Yahshua of salvation, gives he to his king. He said, you give salvation unto me, Almighty Yahweh, and show steadfast loving kindness. That is loving kindness that does not or cannot be moved. And show steadfast loving kindness to his Messiah, to Dawid, and to his Zerah, his seed, forevermore. Tehillim 21, verse 1. If you'll turn quickly. Tehillim 21, verse 1. So in all those things that Yahweh done for Dawid, watching after him, turning his enemies, being the one that take vengeance for the wrong that was done for him, Dawid gave him Todah for those things. He said, thank you, Yahweh. Just simply thank you, Yahweh. He says the same thing here in Tehillim 21 and 1. He says, oh, Yahweh, And in your yasha, your salvation, how greatly shall he rejoice. How greatly should we rejoice, Yisrael Yah? We should rejoice with all that is within us because of what Yahweh has done. He said, you have given him his heart's desire and has not withholden any request of his lips, Selah. For you go before him with blessings of Tov. So Yahweh, he goes before us with blessings of Tov, with the promises. Both those things that are Tov and those things that are Ra, or those things that we call, or we would say are bad things for Almighty Yahweh. But if we will continue in his way, he will continue to bless us with these tough blessings that Yahweh expressed here in verse 3. He said, for you go before him with tough, with blessings of tough, and you set a crown of pure gold upon his head. He asks life of you, and you give it unto him, even lips of days forever and ever. He said in verse 5, that his splendor is great in your yesha, grander and majesty have you laid up for him. For you have made him most blessed forever. So Yahweh has made us his people, his nation, most blessed forever. That we also said you have made him exceedingly glad with your countenance. Do we see the countenance of Almighty Yahweh? Do we believe his countenance is shining down upon us, Yisrael Yah? I believe it is. So let us rest in his countenance, in the gladness of his countenance, Yisrael Yah. Verse 7. For the king trusts in Yahweh, and through the steadfast loving kindness of the Most High, he shall not be moved. That's why we are not moved, Yisrael Yah, because of his steadfast loving kindness, because of his promises, the promises of his Ahava, the promises that he will never leave us, though we have left him. He has not forsaken us, Yisrael Yah. His promises, they stand assured. So we should be glad. We should be excited. We should be happy, Yisrael Yah, even for the things that shall come. Why? Because his Ahava, his love kindness, it endures forever. Tehillim 28, verse 1. Just some verses in Tehillim to give us comfort, Yisrael Yah. Even though we have fallen short, yes, yet his promises still stand assured. But we must walk according to his covenant. Tehillim 28, verse 1. He says, to you will I cry, O Yahweh, my rock. Be not silent to me, lest if you be silent to me, I become like that which goes down into the pit. Verse 2. He says, hear the voice of my supplications. When I cry unto you, Yahweh, when I lift up my hands towards your Kodesh throne or your Kodesh oracle, he says, draw me not away with the wicked. Do we want to be drawn away with the wicked to destruction? He said, draw me not away with the wicked and with the workers of iniquity, which speak shalom to their neighbors, but evil is in their hearts. Do we speak shalom to our neighbors, but yet evil is in our hearts? You know, there's people that do that day to day. How you doing, man? And it's a nice day when all the time there's evil intent in their hearts. Verse 4, he said, to give them according to their deeds, Yahweh, and according to the wickedness of their endeavors. Give them after the works of their own hands and render to them their desert. Verse 5, because they regard not the works of Yahweh, nor the operating of his hands. He shall destroy them, and he shall not build them up again. And he says in verse 6, blessed be Yahweh. Tehillim 28, 6. Blessed be Yahweh, because he has heard my voice of my supplication. Yahweh, he is my strength and my shield. He said that my heart, it trusts in him. He said, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices. And with my song will I praise him. That's what Yahweh desires. That's his reward, Yisra'el, is the praises from our lips. Is giving him Todah. That's what he wants, Yisra'el. Verse 8. He said, Yahweh is their strength. And he is the Yahshua, the salvation, the strength of his Messiah. Verse 9. He says, deliver your people, O Yahweh, and bless your inheritance. He said, shepherd them also. He said, lead them also and lift them up forever. Hallelujah. Is not Yahweh, has he not lifted us up today? He's lifted me up. Hallelujah. Chapter 29, verse 1. This is what we should give unto Yahweh, Yisra'el. He don't want your homes. He don't want the little monies you putting back. He don't want your properties or anything you possesses you think you might have that are worth anything. This is what he desires. Tehillim 29 and 1. He says, give unto Yahweh. What should we give unto Yahweh? O you mighty. He says to give unto Yahweh splendor. Give him honor and give him strength. Those are the things Yahweh wants us to give him. He wants us to exalt the splendidness of his name and his Yahshua and Yahshua HaMashiach. He wants us to dwell with honor and with strength, that we may bring those offerings unto him into his bed. That's what he wants us to give. Verse 2, he says, give to Yahweh the honor. Yahweh, he wants honor. He said, give him the honor that is due to his name. And he wants us to worship him in the beauty of Kodesh, of being set apart, that we aren't like the world. He wants us to worship him in that fashion. Not as the world worship their gods, but as Yahweh commands us to worship him with strength, that we live with honor amongst each other, that we walk according to the Torah. Give unto Yahweh the honor that is due to his name. Worship Yahweh in the beauty of being set apart, of his Kodeshness. It says that the voice of Yahweh is upon the waters. The Almighty, a splendor, he thunders. Yahweh, he is upon many waters. And the voice of Yahweh, it is powerful. The voice of Yahweh, it is full of majesty. The voice of Yahweh breaks the cedar. Yes, it breaks down the cedars of even Lebanon. He makes them also to skip like a calf. Lebanon and Sharon like a young wild ox. The voice of Yahweh divides the flame of fire. The voice of Yahweh shakes the wilderness. Yes, he shakes the wilderness of Kodesh. There's a message that I preached a little while ago concerning the voice of Yahweh. The voice of Yahweh makes the hinds to calve and discovers the forest. And in his great tabernacle does everyone speak of his splendor. So everyone, we should speak of the splendor of Almighty Yahweh. Because in all these voices express great revelation and the things that Yahweh has, that he does, Yisra'el, for us. He says in verse 10 that Yahweh, he is upon the floods. Yes, Yahweh sits king forever. Yahweh will give strength to his people. And Yahweh will, he will bless his people with shalom. So Yahweh, he will bless his people. And all those expressions of his mighty voice, he keeps us. He provides what we need, Yisra'el. He protects us. He continues to send his malach, his messenger, to refresh us, to remind us, and to rebuke us that we stay in this way to the kingdom. Hallelujah. I want to move on to chapter 30. Just move down to chapter 30, verse 1. Tehillim 30, verse 1 says, I will extol you, O Yahweh, for you have lifted me up and has not made my foes to rejoice over me. He said, you have not made my enemies to rejoice over me. O Yahweh, my Almighty, he said, I cried out unto you, and you have healed me. Todiah, that even as we cry out unto him, Yisra'el, he heals us. The balm is there in Galilee to heal us, to make us whole, to anoint us, Yisrael. Verse 3. O Yahweh, you have brought up my nephesh from Sheol, from the earth, from hell, from destruction. He said, you have kept me alive that I should not go down unto the pit. Sing unto Yahweh, O you Kodesh Kedushim of his. Give todah, give thanks. That's what we should give unto Yahweh. He gives us many things. He has given us all things. And all he asks of us is to give him todah. He has already given us the kingdom. He has given us salvation and deliverance through Yahshua HaMashiach. All he wants us to give him is todah. All he wants to get us to give him is all of our life. To give him all praise. Hallelujah. Verse 5. He says, for his anger endures but for a moment. It does not last forever. His favor is life. We have life today. We have life. Not only our physical life, but in Yahshua HaMashiach we have life. So we have favor. We have favor with him. And he says, weeping may endure for an evening, but his joy comes in the morning. So even though the clouds may come, the darkness covers us, that's only for a moment. But why? Because the light of Yahshua shall shine, Yisrael. Hallelujah. For our joy comes in the morning. Let's just move down to verse 8. He says, I cry to you, O Yahweh, and unto Yahweh have I made my supplications for favor. For what profit is there in my blood? There's no profit in our blood. As we heard on Kaveyamit, concerning the blood, Yahweh has pulled us out of our own blood. Our nether cords were not cut. Yahweh said, what profit is my blood? What profit is my line? What profit is the things that I possess and have collected over life? My own wisdom, my own thought. He said, what profit is that? What profit is there in my blood when I go down into the pit? He said, shall the dust praise you? He said, will this physical body in the grave in Sheol, will it praise you? Shall it declare your truth? No man can declare the truth from the grave. He says, hear, O Yahweh, and have hasid upon me. He said, Yahweh, be you my helper. He said, you have turned for me my mourning into dancing. You have put off my sackcloth and girded me with gladness. Hallelujah. Have Yahweh girded us with gladness today? I'm glad. I'm glad because he is in control of everything. Verse 12. He said, to the end that my splendor may sing praises unto you, and not be silent. He said, oh, Yahweh, my Almighty. He said, I will give todah unto you forever. He said, I will give todah. Your praises, Yahweh, will not cease from my mouth. He said, I will give todah unto Yahweh forever. Quickly here to Helium, just to show the foolishness of one that thinks he has an upper hand because of his wealth. And then I want to close this into Helium 79. This is just the fullness of one that thinks he has the upper hand because of wealth. To Helium 49, verse 6. They that trust in their wealth and boast in themselves and the multitude of their riches. It says here, none of them can buy by any means redemption for his brother. He said, by their wealth, they cannot redeem one's nephesh from hell. Money cannot buy one from the judgment of Almighty Yahweh. They're not going to escape. Nor give to Yahweh a ransom for him. You think we're going to persuade Yahweh? A man got $3-4 million, 10, 20, 30, 100 million. You think that's going to persuade Yahweh to save the life of one? It will not. Verse 8. For the redemption of his nephesh is precious, and it ceases forever, that he should live continually and not see corruption. So that is our endeavor, Yisrael. That's what we depend on. That even our lives before Almighty Yahweh, they are precious. Hallelujah. And we shall live continually and not see corruption. It's not by money. It's not by any righteousness we have done. But it's only by the acts and the offering, the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach, that we are redeemed. Not by money. Not by silver nor by gold. But by the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. Again, quickly here, Tehillim 79, verse 6. This is the pension or the plan for life, for relief. He says, pour out your wrath upon the heathen that have not known you, and upon the kingdoms that have not called upon your name. For they have devoured Yaakov and have laid waste his dwelling places. He says, oh, remember not against us our former iniquities. Let your tender husk speedily prevent us, for we are brought very low. Oh, help us, O Yahweh, of our salvation, of our Yeshua, for the splendor of your name, and deliver us and purge away our sins for your name's sake. Wherefore should the heathen say, where is Yahweh, their sovereign master? Let him be known among the heathen and our sight by the vengeance of the blood of your servant, which is shed. He said, let the sighing of the prisoner come before you according to the greatness of your power. Preserve you those that are appointed to die. So it is Yahweh that has preserved us. Though we have been appointed to die, we should have just served the price of our own sins. But yet he has redeemed us. He has reserved us, Yisrael. My last two as I bring this to a close today. He says, and render to our neighbor sevenfold unto their bosom their reproach. He said, pay those that are wicked, pay those back seven times, Almighty Yahweh. Wherein or wherewith they have reproached you, O Yahweh. He says, so we, your people, and the sheep of your pasture will give todah, will give thanks forever. He said, we will show forth your praise unto all generations. Hallelujah. So let us show forth the praises of Almighty Yahweh. Let us walk according to the light of Yahshua HaMashiach and his truth. Let us not set aside the path of Almighty Yahweh for these meagerly ways of the flesh, Yisrael. Because this flesh is nothing before the sight of Almighty Yahweh. But yet, his emunah, the faith that the dwells within us, Yisrael, is worth all things. Because Yahweh has placed so many things in us of Yisrael that we should just give him todah for them. Because without him, we are nothing. Without the Dama Yahshua, we are nothing. Hallelujah. And all he asks, even in all that, is that we just give him todah, we give him thanks. That we give unto Yahweh the honor that is due to his name. Hallelujah. I do barak Yahweh for this time that we have gathered here in the Beit Kol Yisrael Teshua. We'll say Shabbat Shalom and Yahweh barak to all you that are listening by via live stream. To Kol Yisrael that are scattered abroad, that Shalom will rest upon you this day. Let us rest, Yisrael, in comfort, in our sleep, as we fellowship together. Let us not let what is happening in the world or even the things we may face of tomorrow, next week, keep us from giving todah and enjoying this day of rest. As he renews us and he restores us, he energizes us, just like a battery needs recharging. That we may continue to go forth with the task that he has charged us to do on tomorrow. Hallelujah. So let us stand to our feet, Yisrael. Again, we do barak you all that are listening by via live stream. Continue to stand strong, to stand firm on the sure foundation of Yahshua HaMashiach. And let us not go out of the way, neither to the left nor to the right, But let us stay and remain in the place, in this path that Yahweh has given us. Though the famines may come, though the wars may come, doubt may come, let us stand. Let us stand sure in Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. Almighty Yahweh, we do barak you for this another time, this yom, this day you have given us. For we have gathered into your Be'er Abba Yahweh to hear the wonderful words, Abba Yahweh, that has been sent for HaShemayim. Let us rejoice with happiness, with gladness, Abba Yahweh, that we know that you fight all of our battles, Abba Yahweh, that you are the kinsman's redeemer, Abba Yahweh, and you have redeemed us by the dawn of Yahshua HaMashiach. Those that are sick, those that are weak in their bodies, Abba Yahweh, raise them up today, Abba Yahweh. Give them strength in their loins, that they continue to fight this fight of Emunah, Abba Yahweh, and that they do not charge you foolishly, Abba Yahweh, but give you praise in everything, because even in the end of all things, Abba Yahweh, your word, it stands sure, and your word, Abba Yahweh, your word, it is tough, Abba Yahweh. So all things we give you praise, we barak you, we do ask that you would bring Ray out home safely as he returns, Abba Yahweh, and all those, Abba Yahweh, that are out on the highways traveling to get to their destinations, Abba Yahweh, and all things we give you Todah in the precious and mighty name of Yahshua HaMashiach, we do pray. Hallelujah. 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 Shabbat shalom, Yisrael. Shabbat shalom. Hallelujah.